session hijacking. Now first, what is session hijacking? Session hijacking refers to an attack where an attacker takes over a valid TCP communication session between two computers. Now whenever we do what, whenever we connect any server, so basically it do establish the connection between the client machine and the server machine. That means it establishes the connection with TCP. So suppose like I am connecting some web server, I'm accessing a web server, so my machine to that web server, the connection of TCP will be established. Because the web services works on TCP, it uses transmission control protocol for transmitting the data. So TCP do what? TCP establishes the connection before sending any data. So when we connect any of these servers, so it will do what? It will establish the connection. Now what session hijacking is what? That establishes connection, the session. So attacker do what? It hijack the valid communication session between two computer. Now since most authentication only occurs at the start of the TCP session, this allows the attacker to gain access to a machine, and attacker can sniff all the traffic from the established TCP session and perform identity theft, information theft, fraud. The attacker steals a valid session ID and uses it to authenticate himself with the server. So that means it is very simple when a user try to authenticate itself with the server. So it establishes the session with the server. Now when the session is established, they do the authentication. Now after the authentication, once the session is established, then there is no authentication required because you have already authenticated. For example, if suppose you connect to Facebook, first time when you connect the server, it asks for the username and password. When you give the username and password, then after that, whatever the applications, whatever the services you use of on the Facebook, whatever pages you go, whatever users profile you see, whatever you do on Facebook, chatting, waiting, but it will not ask you for the password next time because it is already established, the session is established and you have already authenticated. Now attacker do steal the session in between after you have established the session, and that is called session hijacking. By doing this, it can do the identity theft, because on the server records it is you who is accessing the server, but in between attacker has take over the session. Information theft, and it can also lead to the fraud. Now for doing this, attacker do what? It has to be in the middle of the server and the client, so that it can sniff all the valid session IDs, and then it can authenticate himself as a valid ID, a valid victim, valid user on server. So you can see in this image, like when you establish the connection between the server, you can see the credential transmission and confirmation happens in the beginning of the session. Then the session will be set up. Then whatever the data request, it goes and comes. Then data request goes and comes and goes and comes. Now in that time, the attacker do what? It will sniff the traffic and then it will send data from himself, and it will do this victim as a is denial of service. Put the victim on denial of service and disconnect the victim. Now why session hijacking is successful? Because no account lockout for invalid session ID. That means if you try invalid session IDs, like attacker try to guess the session IDs, it don't know what is the session ID going on, and it will try to guess the session IDs. Now here it can guess as many as it wants. Like it will guess it, fail, guess it, fail, guess it, fail, and it can do unlimited amount of try, because there is no account lockout for invalid session IDs. Then indefinite session expiration time. Now this is the misconfiguration. This is a thing which is misconfigured. It is considered as a misconfiguration in the application. If suppose the application has misconfigured and it has not expiring the session time properly, if it is an undefined session expiration time, then also the session hijacking is successful. then also weak session ID generation algorithm or small session IDs. And this is also a part of misconfiguration. Misconfiguration from the web developers part. Like if the developers of the application have not designed the application to generate the session ID, a complex session IDs and big session IDs, then it can be also a problem. And it is also, it is lead to the session hijacking, this session hijacking is successful because of this. Then most computer using TCP IPs are vulnerable. So most of the PCs which is using the same TCP ID, because they are having this problem of session ID and all, it is vulnerable. Insecure handling of session IDs. This is also lead to the web application developers problem if it is not properly handling the session IDs. And it is doing some misconfiguration at the time of developing the application. These are remain and it will become vulnerability for that applications. Now most countermeasures do not work unless you use the encryption. And here, if you have these vulnerabilities, the most, so all the configuration, most of the countermeasures you use, they will not work unless you use the encryption. So if you use the encryption only, then you can be saved. Now session hijacking process. Session hijacking process is first stealing, then guessing or brute forcing. We have three ways of session hijacking. First is like stealing. Now in stealing, the attacker uses different technique to steal session IDs. Some of the techniques used to steal session IDs are like using the HTTP referral header, sniffing the network traffic, using the cross-site scripting attack, sending Trojan on client machines. Then guessing, session ID guessing means attacker tries to guess the session ID by observing variable parts of the session ID. So attacker has to get the all traffics from this client and server, and then it will try to guess the session ID by observing the traffic. Then brute forcing. Now this, in this, attacker attempts different IDs until he succeeds. So here it will try use the brute force attack techniques, and attacker tries to guess a session ID until he finds the correct session ID. So it will try random session IDs and it will try lots of different session IDs, and then it will try to guess it. It is like a guessing. Now stealing session IDs. So using a referral attack, an attacker tries to lure a user to click on a link malicious site, says this site. Then for example, when they click on that link, so it will send the GET request. Now GET request will look like this. Now the browser direct the referrer URL that contains the user session ID to the attacker site. And now the attacker possess the user session ID. That means when the attacker connects this site which is from the user, from the attackers, so it will use the session ID of that user also. And by this, attacker can guess the session ID of that user. Now session ID brute forcing attack is known as session prediction attack, and if the predict range of values for a session ID is very small, and it is only successful when you are having a weak session ID or guessable session IDs. Otherwise, if you are using a big session ID and encrypted one, then it is not possible to do that. So what is the process we have? First, command injection. So attacker first do what? It will start injecting the command. That means it will start injecting packet to the target server. Then session ID prediction. Take over the session. Here it will try to predict the session ID. It will try to predict the different session IDs and then try to send the different session ID to the server to take over the session. Now if it matches the session ID, so it will establish the connection with the server. Now what about the real user? So the real user, what attacker do? Session desynchronization. It will break the connection to the victim machine. So it will send the unsynchronized packet or session IDs to this victim machine. So the victim machine will feel like the session is finished, or and maybe it can send the finish flag, or it can say that this session is now finished. So to desynchronize the client or victim. Now victim is disconnected and with the same session ID attacker is connected. Now what attacker will do? Monitor the flow of packets and predict the sequence number. Then sniff. Place yourself between the victim and the target. You must be able to sniff the network. So this process start from sniff and then goes to command injection. Now these are the different steps of this process. So the process will start from down to up, from here, from sniff to command injection. So for doing all these things, like injecting the command, predicting the session IDs, desynchronizing the user and monitoring, we have to sniff the traffic first. And for sniffing the traffic, the attacker must come in between the victim and the target server. That means first attacker has to do the man in the middle attack. So when it do the man in the middle attack, then it can do the sniffing. Now when it start doing the sniffing, that means it will start monitoring the traffic. And monitoring the traffic, that means it can predict the session sequence number. Like when the victim is sending the data to the server and server is sending the data to the victim, every data is having a segmented into different packets, and those packets have a unique sequence number. So it try to predict the sequence number also, try to guess or try to see the sequence number. Then it will try to do what? It will try to desynchronize the victim by sending the wrong sequence number. Then the victim will be desynchronized. And now when the victim is disconnected, then attacker try to predict the different session IDs which we have. It has been monitored. It has monitored the session IDs and it has guess the format of the session ID and try to predict the session ID to server. Now once it's successful, then what? It will start injecting the command to server to exploit the server in the name of this victim. Then packet analysis of local session hijacking. Like if local session hijacking, so this is the hijacking. It will work like, you can say it is a packet analysis. So what is happening here? First, user is sending the sync packet. So this is just an analysis where suppose we are getting an example here, like user is sending the sync flag, control ISN number is this, and the type of Windows packet. It is a Windows sync packet. Now the server will send the sync ACK packet. Now here server sync packet comes and server's ICN number is this, and this is also Windows packet, and this is acknowledgement. So this is sync ACK packet and this is the sequence number for it. Now what user machine do? It will send the acknowledgement with sequence number this. Now here the connection will be established. Then the data will go. The data will go from user to server, and in that data also it has the sequence number for the data, because the data has been divided into multiple segments. Then when the data reaches the server, server responds with acknowledgement saying that I have received the data, send me other data, next data with the sequence number. So it sends the next data, then acknowledgement, next data, then acknowledgement. Now here attacker is sitting in the middle of this server and client, and he is watching this traffic. He is watching that what is the sequence number is going for the data and what is the acknowledgement number coming from the server. Now after this data 91, what this attacker do? Attacker do suddenly send the data after this normal data, and what it do here, if you see the sequence number for this is what, 420. That means the server is asking for 420 number sequence packet. So the attacker directly send what? Now is before sending, before this real user is sending the data, attacker is directly sending that data with that sequence number. Now this server feels like it's a genuine packet, and then it will send what? Server will send the acknowledgement that I got this, and now send me this packet, this sequence number packet. And then what, attacker will start sending that packet before the normal user can reply, or before sending this normal this packet, the attacker will do what? It will desynchronize the user so that it will not respond with anything, and attacker will respond with this different data. And different data, that means it can send the malicious data to the server. Now, before the user could send the next data packet, attacker predicts the next sequence number and sends the data to the server. This leads to establishment of the connection between attacker and the server. Now, we have two types of session hijacking, active and passive. In active session hijacking, an attacker finds an active session and takes over. This is what attacker finds an active session and it will take over that session. Now, passive attack, in this, with this passive attack, an attacker hijacks a session but sits back and watches and records all the traffic that is being sent forth. That means attacker take over the session, but it will not do anything. It will just listen for the packets which is coming and going. Now, when I say session hijacking, so it is in OSI model. So where it is happened in OSI model. So in network level hijacking, there is two type of this: network level and application level. Network level, which happens on the network layer of OSI. So network level hijacking can be defined as the interception of the packet during the transmission between the client and the server in a TCP and UDP session. Then application level hijacking means it is about gaining control over the HTTPS user session by obtaining the session ID. So network level hijacking, that means it will steal the session ID from TCP and UDP session. It will intercept and try to predict the sequence number and then insert the command, insert the data with that sequence number before the client, the victim or client responds. Application level hijacking, that means it will take over the web application session. Now, web application session, that means when you connect the web application, it will provide, the application will provide you a session ID with that connection. Now, spoofing versus hijacking. Sometimes we get confused with spoofing and hijacking, but they are different. They are different. Now, spoofing means what? Attacker pretend to be another user or machine, that is victim, to gain access. Attacker does not take over an existing active session. Instead, he initiate a new session using the victim's stolen credentials. That means it will completely start from the beginning. It will first store the credentials and then what? It will use that credential to establish a new connection. That means it is spoofing the identity of that user. It is using the credential of that user to connect the server. It is like spoofing the total identity of that user. So as you can see here in the image, this is the user victim and it is not directly connecting, it is not the connection is not there. Attacker has gained the access of the credential of this user, and then what user attacker will do, what it will send the connection request to the server saying, I am John and here are my credentials. Now hijacking means what? Is the process of taking over an existing active session. An attacker relies on the legitimate user to make a connection and authenticate. So first, this user will do what? It will connect the server. That means John logs into the server with his credential. And then when the connection is established and the session is going on, then this attacker will do what? It will predict the sequence and skill John's connection. Kills John's connection. First, it will predict the session ID or sequence number, and then it will kill the session of John, and then it will send the spoof John's IP and hijack the session. That means it will use the IP of this user John, and then it will start sending the packet by using this the sequence number or the session ID it has predicted. So it will take over the existing session which is already established and authenticated. And that is called hijacking. Now first, application level session hijacking. In a session hijacking attack, a session token is stolen or a valid session token is predicted to gain unauthorized access to the web server. A session token can be compromised in various ways. By doing session sniffing, man-in-the-middle attack, cross-site script attack, session replay attack, or we can say predict the session token, man-in-the-browser attack, cross-site request forgery attack, or session fixation attack. These all attacks attacker can use to steal the session ID, violate session ID, and gain the unauthorized access. It is called application level session hijacking. Now, compromising session ID is by predicting the session token. So compromising the session ID, attacker do what? It will try to predict the session token. Attacker can predict the session IDs generated by weak algorithm and impersonate a web servers, a website user. Now, if suppose these session IDs are weak, it is using the weak algorithm, it is generating a weak session ID. So session the attacker can do impersonate as a user to the web server by just predicting the session ID. Then attacker perform analysis of variable sections of session ID to determine the existence of pattern. So first, before the predicting it, it will do what? It will first analyze the session ID which is already going on and try to predict the pattern. Now, if the algorithm is strong, it will not able to predict. But if the algorithm is not that strong, it can predict the session ID. The analysis is performed manually or by using the various cryptolytic tools. So it can do by manually also, and it can also do by the some cryptolytic tools also. Now, attackers collect a high number of simultaneous session IDs in order to gather samples in the same time window and keep the variable constant. So it will gather a large amount of session ID, and then it will do what? It will try to do and use that as a sample and try to gather the information, and it will try to guess a constant variables from it. Now, how to predict a session token? So most of the web servers use custom algorithm or predict a predefined pattern to generate the session ID. So attacker guess the unique session value or deduce the session ID to hijack the session. Like it has captured, attacker captures several session ID and analyze the pattern. Now if you see this session ID here, it is like a pattern, like this value is constant in every session ID, date. Now if you see closely, it is looking like a date, that means it's a date. And then next it is look like a time, that means it is a time. So now if suppose, for example, if the session ID is like this, it is not like, but session ID is not like this, but if suppose if that pattern, if the attacker has guessed the pattern, then the attacker knows that okay, if this is the pattern, then at this time and in this date, the attacker can successfully predict the session ID. That means at this date and this time, the session ID will be like this. So it can easily predict the session ID if the algorithm is that weak. Then compromising the session ID using man-in-the-middle attack. The man-in-the-middle attack is used to intrude into an existing connection between system and to intercept messages being exchanged. Now remember, for doing this session ID prediction or all, attacker has to get the data. It has to get the data which is going from server to client and victim, and from victim to server. And to do that, attacker have to come into the middle, and it has to do the man-in-the-middle attack. Now attacker use different techniques and split the TCP connection into two connections. So client to attacker connection and attacker to server connection. That means when it comes in between those two machines, then they will not be able to directly connect it. They no longer connect directly. They will go through the attacker machine. That is called man in the middle attack. So whatever the victim sends to the server, it will go first the attacker machine, and then attacker analyze this, and then attacker send it to web server. Now after the successful interception of TCP connection, an attacker can read, modify and insert fraudulent data into the intercepted communication. So when attacker can intercept, when the attacker is in the middle, so attacker can do sniff the data, it can check the data, and it can also manipulate the data what is victim is sending to the server and server sending to the victim. In case of an HTTP transaction, the TCP connection between the client and the server becomes the target. So in case of this HTTP transaction, the TCP connection between this client and the server becomes very becomes the targets, like when it is happening the transition of HTTP connections. Then attacker can compromise the session ID using man in the browser attack also. It is different than man in the middle attack. For this, attacker don't have to come in the middle. Attacker do what? It will use man in the browser attack. And in this, attacker uses a Trojan horse to intercept the calls between the browser and its security mechanism or libraries. That means it will infect the victim machine by using the Trojan, and that Trojan will do what? It will come in between the browser and its security mechanism and libraries. It works with an already installed Trojan horse and act between the browser and the security mechanism. And it means objective is to cause financial deceptions by manipulating the transactions of internet banking system. Basically, this one is for the banking transaction manipulation. So you look the browser, your browser is infected with the Trojan. Now when you go to these banking sites, you will see, you may see some extra fields, like when you go to the banking site, it says please provide the username and password, or maybe some site says please provide username and password and this captcha, that means some random characters are there, you have to type those characters. Now Trojan can do what? It can add some more fields. It can add like provide your credit card number, provide your CVV number, which is very important. It can also add some more fields to get more detail. Now the user will feel like it is a genuine site because it is accessing the genuine site, but because the browser is infected with the Trojan, it can add some extra fields. Now it can also do what? It can also manipulate the transaction. Now when you do the transaction, when you suppose transferring the money to some account, so your request will go through the browser. Now attacker's Trojan is sitting in the browser, in the middle of the browser, and what it do? It will change the transaction. It can change the transaction, it can change the transfer to some other account also. So step to perform man in the browser attack. So steps are like very simple. The Trojan first infect the computer's software, OS or application. Then after the user restart the browser, the malicious code in the form of extension files is loaded. So in the browser, the malicious codes will be loaded. Now when the page is loaded, the extension uses the URL and matches it with the list of known sites targeted for attack. Now it will not do attack on every site. It will do attack on that targeted site which has decided by the attacker and Trojan creator. They have created the list. They will create the list like these are the banking sites and these are the important sites. And if the user goes to this URL, then activate the Trojan. And it do what? It registers a button event handler when a specific page load is detected for a specific pattern and compares it with its targeted list. Then what it do? Oh, sorry, my sequence is not right. It goes from here to here actually. So first is what, after loading the application, the Trojan install malicious code. Trojan install malicious code, extension files, and save it into the browser configuration. Then after the user restart the browser, the malicious code in the form of extension file is loaded. Then the extension files register the handler or a handler for every visit to the web page. So it will check every visit of the web page. Now when the page is loaded, the extension uses the URL and matches it with the list of known sites targeted for attack. That means the Trojan creator have created the list of those important sites like the banking sites and all. So when you go to that URL, when the user goes to those URL, this Trojan will get active. And the user logs in securely to the website. Till then it will not do anything. And after it is logged in securely, then it registers the button event handler when a specific page loaded is dedicated for a specific pattern and compares it with the targeted list. and when the user clicks on the button, the extension uses DOM interface and extracts all the data from all form fields and modifies the values. So actually it will create the submit button. It will create the submit button, which is event handler button. It is an event handler button, but looks like the submit button. User feel like this is the real submit button, and when it tries to fill the form and press the submit, so it will do what? It will extract all the information from it, and then it will do modification also. Then the browser sends the form and modified values to the server. The server receives the modified values but cannot distinguish between the original and the modified value. So after the server performs the transaction, a receipt is generated, and now the browser receives the receipt for the modified transaction. Now the browser displays the receipt with the original details. That means it will do the transaction, and then when the receipt comes, so that receipt will also change by the Trojan, and it will do what? It will show the original transaction which the user has done. Now the user thinks that the original transaction was received by the server without any interception. But there is an interception in between, and the attacker has gained the transaction. Now, compromising the session ID using the client-side attack. Now in client-side attack, we have these different type of attacks. We have cross-site scripting attack, we have malicious JavaScript codes attack, we have Trojan attack. These are all said to be as a client-side attack. Client-side attack, that means it is done on the client side, it is not on the server side. This cross-site scripting enables attackers to inject malicious client-side scripts into the web pages viewed by other users. That means it is also used to do the defacement of site. That means it will do the defacement of the web pages. Now, when other user access the same page, they will see something else. Something else, like they can see the pop-up. That pop-up says that go to this site or go to or do this or do that. That means the pop-up will redirect the user to fake sites. Now when the user goes to the genuine site, because the site is infected by the cross-site scripting from the other user, so this user will feel like this is the genuine thing, and it is saying me to go to this, and it will go there. Like it is what? Injecting malicious script. By using the user's ID, it will inject the malicious code into it by using this cross-site scripting. Then malicious JavaScript codes. This malicious script can be embedded in a web page that does not generate any warning, but it captures session tokens in the background and send it to the attacker. So it do what? In this malicious JavaScript code, that means it embedded with the web page. It is embedded with the web page by using the JavaScript coding. So when the victim goes to that web pages, it will automatically do what? It will not generate any warning. It will directly capture the session token of that user and send back to that attacker machine as it is scripted. Trojans, and simple, we can use the Trojan horses, can change the proxy settings in user's browser to send all the session through the attacker's machine. That means attacker do infect the machine, infect the user by using the Trojan, and make that user change the proxy setting of that user machine, and change the proxies to that attacker is own attacker's own machine. So when the user browse anything on the internet, it will go to the proxy, and proxy is what? The attacker machine, and then there attacker can sniff all those things, and also attacker can manipulate the transaction, manipulate the change, it can manipulate the request also. Then compromising the session ID using the client-side attack of cross-site scripting attack, as I said. So what it do here, if an attacker sends a crafted link to the victim with the malicious JavaScript, so when the victim clicks on the link, the JavaScript will run and complete the instruction made by the attacker. So it do what? Attacker create what? it create a JavaScript link, and attacker sends this malicious link to malicious JavaScript crafted in it, and it will send the link to user or victim, and it will ask the user to click on that link. Now for asking that user to click on that link, for that the social engineering will come into part. Like social engineering, that means attacker will do the social engineering, lure the user to click on that link. Now when the attacker click on that link, user click on the link, the malicious JavaScript runs and it will show like this. It will show a pop-up here. Then what? This pop-up, user follows the instruction made by the attacker and confirm the session identifier, thus attacker steal the session identification. So this pop-up identifier do what? It will ask for the session ID, and when the user click on this or follow the instruction, it will capture the session ID and send it to the attacker machine. The session ID which is already going on, like this user is already connected to its genuine server and it is having a session ID of that user. That means the session is already going on, and at the same time attacker create this fake script and fake a link to send this user with the Java code. So it will click on that link, and then what, like suppose in one tab it is already running this session, in other tab it will open this link, and when it opens the link it will capture the session ID of the existing existing session of the user, and that the session ID it will send it to attacker. Now what attacker will do, it will use the session ID, valid session ID, to connect the server, and it will connect as a this victim user, and then it will disconnect this user and connect himself with the server. Then compromising the session ID is using client-side attack. It is called cross-site request forgery attack. This request forgery attack exploits victim's active session with a trusted site in order to perform malicious activities. So this user is having already active session, a valid session. Now attacker do what? Attacker places malicious link or image on the target website. On the target website, now victims do what? User do what? User logs into the legitimate website here, and then establishes the session with the session ID, and this is like it's a session ID for this user. Now session ID stores the session identifier in the cookie. Now remember, whatever the session ID and session informations are there, they stored into your machine as a cookie. So remember, when you go to some sites, they said that enable cookies because they try to store the information into that cookie. Without cookie some sites won't work. So it stores the session information in their that cookies. So in the session information also, session ID will also be it also is stored into the cookie of this user machine. Now user visit attacker website and click on the malicious link on the website. Now again attacker will do what? It will lure the user to go to that site. Now when the attacker goes to this site, it will click on that malicious link on the website. Then what happened? Attacker gets the user's session ID and gains access to the legitimate website with user session ID and perform malicious operations. Again, when it clicks on this link or this page, attacker gains the access of the session ID, and then it will use the session ID to connect the server. Then we can do compromise the session ID using session replay attack. Session replay attack. Now in this session replay attack, the attacker listens to the conversation between user and the server and captures the authentication token of the user. That means attacker is in the middle and it is listening on the transaction, what is the transmission going and coming, and try to capture the authentication token. Now once the authentication token is captured, the attacker replay the request to the server with the captured authentication token and gain unauthorized access to the server. So that means like it is like user attacker is sitting in the middle and listening the conversation. Now user establishes a connection with the server here. Then server asks for the authentication information for the sake of identity proof. Now when the user is sending the identity authentication request, like it is sending the user information like username and password, so attacker captures this. Attacker eavesdrops on this conversation and captures the authentication token of this user. It captures this, and then what? Attacker replay this captured authentication token to server to gain unauthorized access. That means then it will do what? It will replay that token again, replay this authentication token with its own machine, like its own IP, and it will send it to the server. Now server feels like this is a genuine authentication and it will accept it because it is valid. Now this user's authentication will fail and attacker will connect with this user's authentication token to the server. So attacker do what? It will replay the authentication token by which is sended by the normal user, and it will do what? It will send it to the server by its own behalf. So it is what? Session replay attack. Now session prediction, session ID prediction can be difficult and it is not easy to do that. So attacker can do compromise the session ID by using session fixation command, the session fixation attack. This is an attack that allows an attacker to hijack a valid user session, and the attacker tries to lure a user to authenticate himself with a known session ID and then hijacks the user validation session by the unknown knowledge of the used session ID. So the attacker has to provide a legitimate web application session ID and try to lure victim browser to use it. That means very simple, attacker do what? It will previously it will pre it will create it will use the predefined session ID and send the link to the victim user, and it will ask the victim user to connect the server with using this session ID which is already created by the attacker. Now because it is created by the attacker, attacker knows the session ID, don't have to predict now. So it will send the link of the valid authenticated or authenticated site, this we can say author legitimate site link, web application link with the legitimate session ID. Now when the user click on that link and connect the session ID, connect the user server or web application by using the same session ID which is provided by the attacker. Now first attacker wait till the user is authenticating himself. Now once the user is authenticated, then attacker do what? It will disconnect the user and then it will use the session ID to connect the server. Because the session ID is created by the attacker, so it knows what is the session ID. Several techniques execute the session fixation attack, that is session token in the URL argument, session token in the hidden form field, then session ID in the cookies. So session fixation attack exploits the vulnerability of server which allows a user to use a fixed SID, session ID. Attacker provides a valid session ID to a victim and lures him to authenticate himself using the session ID. So actually what it do here, attacker create a mail and it will create the link, it will give the link with this valid session ID. It will look like this and send it to the victim and ask the victim to click on that link. Now when the victim clicks on that link, the victim will connect the genuine server, legitimate server, and authenticate himself. Now but it is authenticating and using the same session ID. So victim clicks on the link and logs in on the vulnerable server, and also what? Its session ID is under the cookie, but the session ID which is already fixed by the attacker. So attacker knows the session ID. So attacker can do what? Attacker log in with the same session ID which has used for this user to log in. And then it will do what? The same session ID and same cookie it will send to the server and authenticate himself as this user. Now this user will be disconnected because attacker is in the middle, and attacker is doing what? It is listening to the packet. So it will desynchronize the victim, disconnect the victim, and then it will connect himself using the same session ID which is used by this user. Now network level session hijacking. this network level session hijacking is important because this also needed by the application session hijacking. So to do the session application level hijacking, we should also know that network, we have to do the network level hijacking also, because all those packets have to have the session ID as sequence numbers. So we have to predict, the attacker has to predict the proper session sequence numbers also, otherwise it will not be able to do that. So in the network level session hijacking, relies on hijacking transport and internet protocols used by web application in the application layer. So by attacking the network level session, the attacker gathers some critical information which is used to attack the application level sessions. So by using this or attacking the network level session hijacking, it will do what? It will gain some important informations like the sequence number, packet number and all that, IP IDs, all that, so that it can do what? It can use this information to do the application level session hijacking. Like to de-synchronize the user, the victim user. Once the attacker is connected to the server, authenticate, use the session ID to connect it, predict the session ID, or use the fixed session ID to connect the server. Now attacker has to disconnect the victim also. So for disconnecting the victim, it uses a network level session hijacking. Now in this network level session hijacking, it includes blind hijacking, UDP hijacking, TCP/IP hijacking, reset hijacking, man in the middle, packet sniffer, and spoofing source routed packets also. Now first, we should know what is the three-way handshake. If the attacker can anticipate the next sequence and ACK number that Bob will send, he or she will spoof Bob's address and start a communication with the server. So for doing the communication with the server, it has to know the proper sequence and acknowledgement number. So three-way handshake done like this. First, this user Bob sent the server sync packet. That packet sequence number is suppose 4000. Then server will respond with the sync ACK. Now this ACK number is what? 4001 and sequence number is 7000. This is of server. It is not from the Bob. Now Bob will send the ACK again. Now for Bob it is 7001 because 7000 has sent by the server, and sequence number it will give 4001 because previous sequence number for the user was 4000. So next will be 4001. So this is what the three-way handshake. Now attacker has to predict or have to get the proper sequence number to send the data to attack to the server machine, so that it can when it predict the session ID. So when it try to send the session ID to the server to hijack the session, it has to know the next sequence number also, so that it can predict the right sequence number and also the session ID, and try to insert the packet to the server. So Bob initiate. Now what is the process here? Bob initiate the connection with the server and sends a packet to the server with the sync flag set. The server receives the packet and sends back the pack, sent back with the sync ACK flag and the ISN, that is initial sequence number for the server. Then Bob sets the ACK flag, acknowledge the recipient of the packet, and increments the sequence number by one. Now the two machines successfully establishes the connection. This is what the three-way handshake. Now based on that, attacker can do the TCP/IP hijacking. Now in this attacker, in this hacking technique, that uses spoof packet to take over the connection between a victim and the target machine. So the victim's connection hangs and the attacker is then able to communicate with the host machine as if the attacker is the victim. To launch TCP/IP hijacking attack, the attacker must be on the same network as the victim, and the target and the victim machine can be anywhere. So for doing this, attacker must be on the same network as a victim, but the target and the victim machines can be anywhere. That means the target machine can be anywhere, but attacker must be in the same network of the victim. So it can do this. Now what it will do here, as you can see here in the image, the victim sends the data packet here. This is the IP of that victim, Now victim is sending this. This is the IP source and destination of this server. The sequence number will be this, acknowledge number will be this, the length of the packet is this. Now the server machine sends a response with the old sequence number and acknowledge number of the victim plus packet length. It is, for example, like this: source and destination, sequence number, acknowledge number and length. Now attacker knows that what will be the next. Now attacker will do what? It will spoof the IP address of the victim. That means source ID, IP address, you will see 192.168.0.100 is here. It is using the victim's IP address, sending the data to this destination server. Now sequence number, because it has sniffed the data, it knows the what, it knows that what is the next sequence number and what is the next acknowledge number, acknowledgement number, and it will send the data to this server. So TCP/IP hijacking process. The attacker sniffs the victim's connection and uses the victim's IP to send the spoof packet with the predicted sequence number. Then the receiver process of the spoof packet increments the sequence number and sends acknowledgement to the victim IP. Now the victim machine is unaware of the spoof packet. So it ignores the receive machines, it ignores the receiver machine's acknowledging packet and turns sequence number count off. Now here what happened, the victim will be desynchronized from the server. Now because suppose, for example, server victim is sending the packet sequence number 1 to the server. Now server says, server send back 2. Now victim has to send the 3. But the victim, apart from victim, the attacker will send the sequence number 3. Now victim don't know that somebody has sent the sequence number 3. So when attacker get the response of 2, attacker will also send, try to, when the attacker sends the sequence number 3, now server will ask for sequence number 4. Now victim machine is waiting for the response of 3, but it is getting that, it is getting a 4. Now what? Victim machine feels like this is what, this is not the right sequence number, and it will desynchronize. Therefore the receiver receives packets with the incorrect sequence number, and the attacker forces the victim connection with the receiver machine to desynchronize the state, and the attacker tracks sequence number and continuously spoof packet that comes from the victim's IP, and the attacker continues to communicate with the receiver machine while the victim connection hangs. So this will help the attacker to desynchronize the victim. When it predicted the right session ID and connected the server, now it has to desynchronize the real victim to disconnect. So it can do this TCP/IP hijacking. So it can read, it can desynchronize the victim machine. For example, what is happening here when this victim sends the data to the server, let's say for example the sequence number is what, let's say it is 10. Now when the server responds, it will send 11. Now what is the next sequence number is 12. Now this client has to send 12. Now before, because the attacker is in the middle and it is sniffing the packet, so it will do what? It will send itself with the victim's IP. It will use the victim's IP and it will send the next sequence number packet to establish the connection with the server. Now the server gets the 12 from here, so when this server victim sends, now victim will also try to send the 12. But the attacker do what? It will drop this from here in the middle. It will not pass, it will not allow this to go. Now the server sends what? Now remember, server will know this victim's IP. So server will send the data to this victim. Now server will say like, I need what? This, my next sequence number is 30. Now this victim machine says, I have not get any reply from you and I want to send 12. Now you are saying 30. What that means? Now attacker, now this victim machine will start not responding now. because it is confused. It is not, it don't know where this 13 is coming. But attacker can see that. Attacker will reply with 14 now. Now the server will say, now I need 15. Now what? The victim machine will be completely desynchronized. It don't know any, it does not know any, it doesn't have any idea about what sequence numbers are going on. Now this victim machine assumes that the connection is not running and it is now closed. So victim machine feels like the connection is closed, but the connection is now running from this attacker's machine. Now whatever the sequence number server sends to this victim, it will be ignored. That means this victim machine will not respond to any sequence number. But the response will come from, remember, because the IP is spoof, so response from this, reply from this server will always go to this victim. It will not go to this attacker machine. But the victim machine now ignores every packet. Why? Because it does not know about the sequence number. So it will ignore every packet. But because the attacker is sniffing the data, it will know that what is going on. And it will send the next packet according to the sequence number. And it will keep establish the connection with the this target server, and then it is work. It will help this TCP/IP hijacking help this attacker to desynchronize and disable this user or disconnect this user, and then it can predict the session ID, and then it can establish the session with this server in the name of this victim's machine. IP spoofing, source routed packets. So packet source routing technique is used for gaining unauthorized access to a computer with the help of a trusted host IP address. Again, what here attacker is doing? Attacker is spoofing the IP address of the valid host. The attacker spoofs the host IP address so that the server managing a session with the local with the host account, the packet from the attacker. Host accept the packet from the attacker. When the session is established, the attacker injects forged packet before the host responds to the server, and the original packet from the host is lost as the server gets the packet with the sequence number already used by the attacker. That is what I have said before. The packets from attacker are source routed through the host with the destination IP specified by the attacker. So attacker is doing what? It is getting in the middle, and it is doing also source routing. That means it is using the spoof IP. That means when it predicts the sequence number, it uses the victim's IP address. Now the packet goes to the server, and when the server responds, it will go to the victim machine, but victim will ignore those packet, ignore those response, because now it is in desynchronized, because the sequence number is now not synchronized. But attacker at the same time, attacker keeps sending the right sequence number packets to the server. Then also attacker can do reset hijacking. Now reset hijacking involves injecting an authentic looking reset packet using spoof source address and predicting the acknowledgement number. The hacker can reset the victim's connection if it uses an accurate acknowledge number. The victim believes that the source actually sent the reset packet and resets the connection. And reset hijacking can be carried out using the packet crafting tools such as these Cola Sort Packet Builder and TCP/IP analysis tools such as TCP Dump. Again, in this, what attacker do? Attacker try to disconnect the victim. When it is established the connection, it will try to disconnect the victim so that it can use the session of that victim. So what it do here, it will keep sniffing the packets, and when the victim sends the data packet, so it will like source and destination and sequence and acknowledging number. Now when the server machine sends the response, now remember the acknowledgement number is this. Now attacker knows what will be the next acknowledgement number. So attacker spoof the address of the server machine and then it do what? It predict the next acknowledgement and sequence number, but it will send what? Reset packet instead of other data. That means server is sending the acknowledgement, it is sending some other data to the victim, but it will spoof the packet here and it will send the reset with the same valid acknowledgement number. Now the victim feels like the server has sent the reset packet. That means, now reset packet means reset the connection, reset the TCP connection and close the TCP session. So when it gets the reset packet with the server IP, so attacker spoof the server's IP, send the reset packet through the victim. Now victim machine will accept the packet only when the acknowledgement number is correct. So it do predict the acknowledgement number and sends the reset to reset the connection. Now what happened here, victim reset the connection, victim machine, and it will disconnect the session, close the session. Now it is no longer listening to this session. Now at the same time, attacker has gained the access of the by predicting the session ID, and it is now connected the server with the session ID of this victim. Now responses, now remember the reply will always go to the victim machine because the attacker is using the IP of this victim, it is spoofing the IP addresses. But attacker can also see the reply because it is in the middle, and it will send the reply from the attacker machine by using the victim's IP. Now reply will also go to the victim machine. Victim machine will not do anything because it will ignore everything, because the victim machine feels like the session is already finished, so we don't have to do anything now. Then attacker can do blind hijacking. The attacker can inject the malicious data or commands into the intercepted communication in the TCP session even if the source routing is disabled. Now source routing is disabled, the attacker can still do the still inject the malicious data or commands into the intercepted communication TCP session. The attacker can send the data or comments but has no access to see the response. Now in this case, suppose the attacker is not having a source routing is disabled, attacker is not in the middle. Now when it is not in the middle, that means it will not see the response of server. Now here attacker do what? Attacker do blind hijacking. That means attacker only predict, it will not know, it is not seeing any we can say any reply from the server. So when the victim sends a request to the server, attacker intercept the request, then attacker injects the malicious code in the request and forward it to the server. But the reply, when the reply comes, the attacker will not see the reply. It has to do this blindly, and that is why it is called blind hijacking. Next is this man in the middle attack using forged ICMP and ARP spoofing. Now in this attack, the packet sniffer is used as an interface between the client and the server. ARP spoofing involves fooling the host by broadcasting the ARP request and changing its ARP tables by sending the forged ARP replies. The packet between the client and the server are routed through the hijacker host by using two techniques. So it is actually doing what? For man in the middle. Now because all the session hijacking techniques are depend on man in the middle attack, so here how you do the man in the middle attack. We can do this man in the middle attack by using ARP spoofing, or we can also use this ICMP, forge ICMP, using the forge ICMP also. In using the ARP address resolution spoofing, we use ARP. ARP is used to map the network layer address, that is IP address, to link layer address, that is MAC address. So by sending the fake spoof and a fake reply to the victim machines and the other server, victim machines and the server, that believing poisoning the cache of ARP on victim and server machine, that the IP address, the MAC address of this victim is the attacker machine's MAC address, and IP address of MAC address of the server is also attacker's MAC address. So whatever the data goes and comes from the server and client, it will go through the MAC address or through the server machine. It is what ARP is spoofing. Also, we can use this forge ICMP ICMP protocol also. It is an this ICMP is an extension of IP to sending error messages, where the attacker can send message to fool the client and send the server. This attack is to do the man in the middle attack, because it is important for the sniffing, for the session hijacking. So what it do here, it sits in between the server and the client, or maybe suppose this is the internet router and this is the victim machines. Now attacker wants to get in between these two things, so that when the victim machine go to the internet, it has to go through the victims, the attacker machines. So attacker can do use this ARP spoofing. So ARP spoofing, that means when any machine wants to get the MAC address, IP MAC address of any IP address. Suppose if this machine wants to send data to this machine or router, so it first need to have a MAC address of this router. So it first run the ARP request. It will send the ARP request for this MAC address. It goes like a broadcast, and nobody will reply. Only this machine, this router, will reply its own MAC address, with its own MAC address, to this victim, this client. And the client will do what? It will cache that information in the ARP cache. Now what attacker do? Attacker poison the cache of this victim machine and the server machine or the router, so that whenever they send the data, they believe that this IP is having this MAC address, the MAC address of the attacker. Now for example, what this machine IP is, let's say 10, MAC address is A, and this machine's, this router's IP is 11, MAC address is B. Now remember, attacker machine's MAC address IP is 12 and MAC address is C. Now attacker or every machine knows they have cache. They have the cache, which in the cache they have the information about the MAC address and IP address. So when they do the first time communication, so first time they do the ARP request, ARP broadcast, to get the MAC address and IP address. Then once it gets, then they do what? Cache. So first, suppose, let's say if this machine, attacker machine, wants to know about this machine's MAC address, IP address is 10 and MAC address is A. So what this machine will do, it will send the ARP request, ARP request packet to everyone, and asking for the one like, which IP, who is this 10? Now this 10 machine will reply with its own MAC address, and it will be cached here on the on this machine, like it says that this is the IP address and this is the MAC address. So it sends the request, get the reply. It wants to know MAC address about of this machine, so it will send the request for this IP, and it will reply with its own MAC address, and it will cache in the attacker machine or any machine. So all the machines do this. They do cache the ARP, they do cache the MAC address and IP address of the other machines. Now what attacker do? It will try to poison the cache of these two machines. How it will do? It will send, they have not sent any request, but attacker will directly send the reply. And in the reply, it says that this my machine's IP is 11 and my MAC address is C. Now C is the right MAC address of this attacker machine, but the IP it is saying to this machine is of this internet router. So it is poisoning the cache of this machine, saying that this IP's MAC address is C, but actual MAC address of this IP is B. And same thing it will do on this side also. It will send directly reply, and it says that my IP is 10 and this is my MAC address. Again, it is wrong information. The IP, this machine's IP MAC address is A, but attacker sends the request or reply to this machine, the router, and says that my IP is 10, the 10 IP, that means this victim's IP, but the MAC address is what? Attacker's machine. Now when this machine wants to send the data to this window, this machine, this victim machine or user, it will send the machine, it will send the data to the switch. Now when it sends the data, the IP will be 10, but the MAC address will be C. Now switches don't know the MAC address, switches don't know the IP address, it knows only MAC address. So switch says, where is this C MAC address? So it will say, okay, this is here. It will send it to attacker. Same thing happened to this machine also. When it send, it wants to send the data to this router. So whatever the data it will send, the IP address will be router's IP address, but the MAC address will be attacker's. Now switch will do what? It will say, okay, this is the MAC address, now go here. So all the data which is coming from 10 going to 11, it will go to attacker machine. And whatever the data going from 11 to 10, it will also go to attacker machine. Then attacker do here, it will do here what? It will do start the forwarding. Forwarding in its machine. Now forwarding means the attacker machine will start working as a router. So when the data comes for 10, this IP 10, it will receive by the attacker machine, but it checks this IP is not my IP, so it will forward the data to this 10 IP. Because it knows the right MAC address, it will send the data to the right machine. And again, when the data comes from 10 and wanted to go to 11, so attacker says that, okay, this is not my IP, so it will forward the data to this machine. And now it knows the right MAC address, so it will reach the data directly, correctly to this router. Now what happening here, all the data communication between this IP 11 and 10, they are connected, but they are connected through the attacker machine. And in this attacker machine, attacker will sniff the data and it can change the data also. So by using these techniques, by using this ARP spoofing or this ICMP, it can do what? It can come in the middle and then it can do the other attacks. Then it has one more, UDP hijacking. So in the network level session hijacking, where the attacker sends the false server reply to a victim UDP request before the intended server replies to it. Now remember, in TCP the connection is established, but in UDP no connections are established. For the UDP protocols, no connections are established, it will just throw in the packet. It is like a broadcasting or transmitting the packet without any author acknowledgement. So in this case, what attacker do? It will send the forged reply before the victim machine replies or the server replies. The attacker uses man-in-the-middle attack to intercept the server responses to the client and sends its own forged reply. That means the client sends the request to the server. Now before the server even reply it, the attacker reply with the request. Now the server will reply will be dropped here and the attacker reply will go to the client machine. It can do that because the attacker is in the middle. Now we have different session hijacking tools. We have Zproxy. Zproxy is the it is called Zproxy also. It is a AWOWASP Z attack proxy. It is called ZAP. Is an integrated penetration testing tool for finding vulnerabilities in web applications. It can intercept all the requests, get and post all these requests. It can intercept, and also we can modify the requests, and we can do the replay attacks. This is features of this tool is intercepting the proxy, active scanner, passive scanner, brute forcing scanner, spider infuser, port scanning, dynamic SSL certificates, API, bean shell integration. These are the features for this tool, Zproxy. Then session hijacking tools, we have Bobsuit, we have JHijack. Bobsuit allows the attacker to intercept and modify the traffic between the browser and the target application. So if the attacker is sitting in the middle, so it can intercept all the requests from the server to the client and client to the server. And it can do also modify by using these tools. It analyzes all kind of content with automatic colorizing of request and response syntax. Then again, the J hijack is also, it is Java hijacking tool for web application session security assessment. A simple Java fuzzer mainly used for numeric session hijacking and perimeter enumeration. It is to predict and enumerate the session hijacking session IDs. Then we have other tools like these servjack, ittercap, temper IE. We have tsite, SSL strip. SSL strip will do what? It will strip the SSL session from in between. When the attacker is in the middle, it can strip the SSL session. And then these are the other tools like FreeShib, Cookie Kegger, FreeJack. Now we have session hijacking tools for mobiles also, like DroidSheep and DroidSniff. DroidSheep is a simple Android tool for web session hijacking, or we can say sidejacking. It listens for HTTP packets sent via wireless, that is 802.11 network connections, and extracts the session ID from these packets. Then DroidSniff. DroidSniff is an Android app for security analysis in wireless network and captures Facebook, Twitter, and LinkedIn and other accounts. So it will sniff all these accounts information. Now, what are the countermeasures? Session hijacking detection methods. To detect the session hijacking, we have two methods, manual or automatic. In manual method, we use the packet sniffing software, we use the normal telnet session or using an ARP entry. Or in automatic method, intrusion detection system, IDS, we use the IDS, or we can use intrusion prevention system, that is IPS. They can do automatically detect the hijacking attacks. So protection against the session hijacking. What is the protections? Use the secure shell. Use SSH to create a secure communication channel. Pass through the authentication cookies over HTTPS connection. Implement the logout functionality for user to end the session. Generate the session ID after successful login and accept the session ID generation generated by server only. That means first use the encryption, then when you send the session cookies from server to client or client to server, use the HTTPS connection that is secure. Then implement the logout functionality. That means whenever user logs into the site, you should have to provide the logout functionality also. That means if the user is not logging out properly, if it is directly closing the browser, that might be session will be keep running. Suppose you directly close the browser instead of logging out, then what happened? Your session might keep run. It will keep running and session will not disconnect. Now generate the session ID after successful login. It will save us from the session fixation attack. Now because after authentication, the new session ID should be generated so that attacker is not able to do the session fixation attack. Ensure the data in transit is encrypted and implement defense in depth mechanism. Again, encryption. Use string or long random number as a session key. So when you are creating or configuring the session keys, use the random and long numbers. Use different usernames and password for different accounts. This is for the users. Don't use the same username and password for every account. Educate the employees and minimize the remote access. Minimize the remote access. Educate the employees to log in directly. Don't use remotely. Ensure client side and server side protection software are in active state and up to date. So whatever the protection softwares we have installed on client and server, they must be updated and up to date. Use switches rather than hubs, because in hubs sniffing is very easy. Do not transport session ID in query strings. Then implement timeout to destroy the session when expired. That means whenever you logged out or you suppose close the browser directly, it should destroy the session. Use a strong authentication like Kerberos or P2P VPNs. Configure the properties appropriate internal and external spoof rules on gateways. Use IDS protective products or ARP watch to monitoring the ARP cache poisoning attack. Use encrypted protocols that are available at OpenSSH suite. OpenSSH comes with the different encrypted tools also, like SFTP, SCP, SSH. Now, method to prevent session hijacking to be followed by web developer. That means because the attack is based on the web applications, so these are the things which the app developer must be considered when they are creating any web application. So they should create the session key with lengthy strings and or random number, so that it is difficult for the attacker to guess a valid session key. Generate the session ID after the successful login to prevent the session fixation attack. Encrypt the data and session key that is transferred between the user and the web server, so that attacker cannot see the session key easily. Expire the session as soon as the user logged out. So whenever the user logs out, session should be expired. Prevent the eavesdropping within the network. Eavesdropping within the network, that means use the encryption technique. Reduce the lifespan of session or a cookie. Now these cookies, some applications cookies can remain active till years. That means for the long period of time, like from 1 year, 1 month, 1 year, 2 year also. So you should reduce the lifespan of the session cookies. Then the method to prevent session hijacking, then this is to be followed by the web users. Do not click on the links that are received through the mails or IMs, internet messages. Like, do not click on those link because it can be a session fixation. Use firewalls to prevent the malicious content from entering the network. Use firewall and browser setting to restrict the cookies, and make sure that the website is clear, certified by the certifying authorities. That means when you go to any site, make sure the site is secure by the certificate. Make sure the site is using HTTPS, and also the certificate is valid. Sometimes you will see the certificate, but it is not understand. It is not valid. The certificate is not valid. So don't use that site and don't put important information on those sites. Make sure you clear history offline content and cookie from your browser after every confidential and sensitive transaction. Prefer HTTP as secure transmission rather than HTTP. Use HTTPS rather than HTTP when transmitting sensitive and confidential data. Log out from the browser by clicking on log out button instead of closing the browser. Then approaches vulnerable to session hijacking and their prevention solution. So vulnerable to session hijacking is telnet and R logging, because they work in clear text. So we should use OpenSSH, SSH or SSH secure cell. It sends encrypted data and make it difficult for the attacker to send the correctly encrypted data if session is hijacked. Instead of FTP, use SFTP tool. SFTP is the part of OpenSSH toolkit, and it reduces the chance of successful hijacking because it uses encryption. Then instead of HTTP, use SSL socket layer. It reduces the chances of successful hijacking. It becomes HTTPS. It provides the security by encrypting the session. Instead of IP, use IPsec. It prevents the hijacking by securing IP communication. Any remote connection like VPN, don't use any remote connection, use VPN. Implementing encrypted VPN such as PPTP, L2TP, IPsec, etc. for remote connection prevents session hijacking. SMB server message block, use SMB signee. It improves the security of the SMB protocol and reduces chances of session hijacking. Hub network or switch network, don't use hub, use switch to mitigate the risk of ARP spoofing and other session hijacking attacks. So it says that every time it says that use encryption. So how we can use encryption? Okay, that means for using the encryption, so how we can use? We can use IPsec. IPsec provide the encryption technology, encryption mechanism to secure the normal IP connection. Remember, by default, normal IP connection is not secure. So we can secure that by using the IPsec, IP security. This is the IPsec architecture, where you have AH protocol and ESP protocol. That is authentication algorithm and encryption. secure payload protocol. It is actually protocol. So encryption algorithm, AES provide the authentication algorithm, and ESP protocol provide the encryption algorithm. Then IPsec domain of interpretation, that is DOI. There is policies and there is key management. So basically it do what? It provides the security by using the keys, encrypted keys, public and private keys. Components of this IPsec are like IPsec driver, the software that performs the protocol level function that are required to encrypt and decrypt the packets. Then internet key exchange, that is IKE, this protocol that produce this, this is a protocol which produces the security keys for IPsec and other protocols. Internet Security Association key management protocol, the software that allows the allows two computers to communicate by encrypting the data that is exchanged between them. And Oakley, the protocol which uses the Diffie-Hellman algorithm to create master key and a key that is specific to each session in IPsec data transfer. IPsec policy agent, this is a service of the Windows 2000, collect IPsec policy settings from the Active Directory and sets the configuration to the system at startup. So whenever your system starts, it sets the IPsec and make the connection secure. So in a simple way, when we say how it secures the connection, it uses a key mechanism to secure the connection. So actually it do what? It configures the, when we configure the IPsec on this device, these servers, so it do what? It generates two keys. That means it generates the public key and private key. Then what? It sends the public key to the other client. Now whatever the data this client wants to send, it will encrypt the data and put the lock on that data by using that key. Now when it sends the data to the server, so server will decrypt the data by using its own public key. Now if the attacker is in the middle and it try to sniff the data, it will not be able to see what is the data because the data is encrypted. Now remember, when the first time it sends the key, like when it generates the public key and it try to send the public key to the other machine, the client, at that time if the user attacker gets that key, it can see that key. If it can get that key, that means it can do what? It can decrypt all the communications. So for securing that, it uses the Diffie-Hellman algorithm, that Diffie-Hellman algorithm, to secure this key and securely transport the key to the client. Now that algorithm, that hashing algorithm, is the toughest one, and that is very very strong algorithm. So no one can decrypt that one. So if the attacker gets the key, it will not be able to decrypt it or not be able to see that key. So it is secure than that. So it uses this IPsec, uses two keys, public and private, to secure the connection from client to server. Now finally, penetration testing. So for penetration testing, locate the session first. To start, locate the session. Session ID is used in URL or not. Now if it is not, then go for session is encrypted or not. If the session ID is used in URL, so sniff the session traffic between two machines. If the session ID is not used in that URL, then we have to sniff the session ID, sniff the traffic to get the session ID. If suppose the session ID is used in URL, sometime it is used in the URL, it shows in the URL. So we can go for the next step, like session is encrypted or not. Now if it is not showing the session ID there, then we have to sniff to get the session ID. And then next step is to check the session is encrypted or not. Now if the session is encrypted, then abort or use the Trojan to perform the session hijacking. Now, if the session is not encrypted, remember, if it is encrypted, then no way the user can get. So it will go for the Trojan and go for the man in the browser attack. Now, if it is not encrypted, then the next step is to session ID is recovered or not. We try to recover the session ID, and if it is not recovering, that means use the automated tool to hijack the session, like sniffing the session traffic, this using the Wireshark, WinCAP, try to make the proxy Trojan, try to use the automated tools such as Zproxy or Bobsuite or that, and crack the session ID if the URL is embedded. Now, if the session ID is recovered, then session ID is encrypted or not. Now, if the session ID is encrypted, if it is not encrypted, then we can go directly on phishing mails and use the session fixation attack. Send the link to the victim, phishing mail, and send the link with the session ID. The victim will use the session ID with that fixed session, use the link with the fixed session ID, then it can be, we can use the session ID again. And if it is not, if it is encrypted, then try to crack the session ID encryption. And if it is encrypted, then it is very difficult. Then make normal connection with one of the machine, collect the several session IDs, predict a new session ID, replay a new session ID, then connection established or not. If the connection is established, then document all the findings, and if it is not, then try to use the brute forcing to get the session ID. This is what the penetrating steps, and this is the session hijacking topic.